Matthew H. Forrest is a successful entrepreneur, metaphysician, and world traveler, dividing his time mainly between Southeast Asia and Europe. He is the author of the upcoming screenplay trilogy, Selfish Genes, The Enlightenment, God's Dice, and Exit Strategy, fiction work that is heavily based on the concepts in this book, as well as the upcoming business book, Off-Grid Entrepreneur. He is also an inventor, a non-exec music producer slash songwriter, and artist and CEO of itsaglobal.com and I Am Music AG.
The meaning of life. When the black dog is barking up the right tree, by M H Forrest. No part of this book may be reproduced or transmitted in any form or by any means, electronic or mechanical, including copying, recording, or by any other information storage and retrieval system without permission in writing from the publisher. For information, address It's a Global Books. To set the scene for the audiobook, we begin with an excerpt from the It's a Global Records track It's a Stairway to Heaven by Matt Huxley featuring Blood and Soul, the Daniel Whittaker and Jamie Hardman mix.
There's a lady who's sure all that glitters is gold, and she's buying a stairway to heaven. When she gets there, she knows if the stores are closed. With a word, she can get why she came from. Buying a stairway to heaven. There's a sign on the wall, but she wants to be sure, 'cause you know sometimes words have two meanings.
To enjoy the official video, go to ITZA Stairway on YouTube. Chapter 1. Do not believe in anything simply because you have heard it. Do not believe in anything simply because it is spoken and rumored by many. Do not believe in anything simply because it is found written in your religious books. Do not believe in anything merely on the authority of your teachers and elders. Do not believe in traditions because they have been handed down for many generations. But after observation and analysis, when you find that anything agrees with reason and is conducive to the good and benefit of one and all, then accept it and live up to it. Hindu prince Gautama Siddhartha, the founder of Buddhism, 563 to 483 BC. Introduction. Although this book has some elements that you would expect in a self-help book, it is more of an exploration of the human mind, our mental as well as perceived physical reality, and to a lesser extent, mood disorders, and what they all reveal about the meaning of life. It is often said that you only miss things once they are gone, but it does not take a great deal of imagination to get a sense of that future reality without actually experiencing it. This is one of the clear benefits of the modern mind and its ability to simulate future potential realities, albeit with some major flaws discussed in the book. With mood disorders, I do not think this is the case, and only those who experience it can understand how profound the feelings are. It is the impact feelings have on their whole life and their reality that makes it hard to relate to unless you have actually suffered such a condition. It doesn't help that the term depression denotes sadness, as well as the profound emotional state and disease. To say they differ in the way that the common cold and influenza do is a gross understatement. This is a serious and growing epidemic and is now the number one cause of disability in the world. It deserves our attention. I will make an argument that, although there are distortions caused by depression, it can also provide 20/20 vision, some inconvenient truths, as well as some deeper truths that ultimately point us towards answering the age-old question about the meaning of life. I think the implications are even more far-reaching than the mistaken revelation by Charles Darwin that we are mere naked apes descended from basic creatures via the evolutionary process. The discussion is based on science and logic, So although a past or present experience of depression may be required for someone to feel that what is in this book is true, when it comes to mood disorders and what they tell us about meaning, a non-sufferer will be able to see the same truths from the words alone. This is something other than a book about mood disorders. However, it is often disease and malfunction that leads us to a greater understanding about anatomy and physiology, and as mood disorders are a deviation from the norm, they cause us to look deeper into the sense of meaning that most take for granted. As mood is inextricably linked with a sense of meaning, a disorder allows us to explore the state of meaninglessness that can tell us about the nature of meaning. An exploration of mood disorder is therefore critical, but a human sense of meaning is only a part of the overall meaning of life picture, and the book covers a multitude of other relevant subjects. When people ask what is the meaning of life, there are at least three things they could be asking. What is the purpose of life from a scientific perspective? What is this experience we label as meaning that is unique to specific humans, and perhaps, to a lesser extent, experienced by other higher life forms? And what is the ultimate cause for everything, and why is there something as opposed to nothing, as well as so much order? The book addresses all of these questions. The black dog in the book title refers to depression and is the term one of its bite victims, Sir Winston Churchill, used to describe it. The phrase, when the black dog is barking up the right tree, is a deliberate abuse of the common phrase that refers to a dog barking up the wrong tree. For example, wasting time pursuing an idea because even the most basic assumptions are wrong, e.g. when a cat it is chasing ran up a different tree from the one it is barking up. The tree in this instance refers to the tree of life, although it is purposefully illustrated as having sprouted from mind stroke consciousness rather than soil. The black dog is deemed to be barking up the right tree rather than the wrong tree because depression can lead to insights that fall under the radar of most people who are fully focused on the process of living. On the other hand, the condition removes the rose-coloured spectacles worn by those totally engrossed in the minutiae of what goes on in the bubble, and thus can provide a clearer picture by providing a detached perspective. On the other hand, an encounter with meaninglessness that often accompanies the condition gives experiential evidence to help show us what meaning actually is, how it arises, and its origins. Some of the contents of the book are very emotive, and there may be parts that clash with your belief system. Parts of it are a journey into existential angst and not for the faint-hearted. Ignorance can be bliss, and maybe those who are pretty fulfilled most of the time should steer clear of the rabbit hole. Conversely, Socrates expressed his view that the unexamined life is not worth living. And besides, although there will be dark aspects of reality you will almost certainly not have considered until you've read the book, there are revelations concerning scientifically proven magic, which, I believe, are also key in understanding the meaning of life in its broader sense. Furthermore, the journey will force you to realise that the true nature of reality differs from our instinctive perception of it by an unimaginable degree and will provide insights into the ultimate cause that mainstream science currently takes for granted. Parts of my worldview may be other than yours, but the possibility of slight deviations from the truth would not alter the overall paradigm shift that is presented. Besides, many highly qualified academics who have dedicated much of their life to the matters discussed in this book have scientific conclusions that concur with my own ponderings and accordingly serve as a reality check. Although countless hours of deep thought were needed to assemble the jigsaw puzzle of what I believe to be the meaning of life, I am not claiming to have special knowledge or skills, but to have merely connected the dots through my personal experience. Hopefully, sound logic and strong empirical evidence, in other words, Buddha's, but after observation and analysis, when you find that everything agrees with reason, etc., can counter the human predisposition towards confirmation bias, in other words, filtering evidence so that only information which fits one's worldview is permitted a place in the mind. I think that even the most reputed scientists are often guilty of this. For example, Professor Richard Dawkins mistakenly believed that all roads lead to Darwin. There is no doubt that Darwin identified a pattern that only a small percentage of people would have noticed with all the evidence he had collected, including the fact that selective breeding at the time was showing the plasticity of living entities. However, for Dawkins to suggest that the potentiality for reality, space-time, life, the driving force within the process of evolution itself, etc., can all be explained by reductionism too, is nothing more than a belief. There is no credible scientific explanation for such arbitrary potentialities. In other words, despite these potentialities being the miracle of all possible miracles, they are simply accepted as axiomatic. The existence of such potentialities encoded into the laws of nature do not reveal anything about their ultimate cause, and neither do the manifestations of such potentialities. Atheists refer to disputing their worldview that nature stroke reality exists because it just does, along with the potentialities now manifest, as looking for God in the gaps. However, whether the anthropic principle discussed later in the book is applied or not, there is a miracle at the root of our reality. Even if you assume that it has all come about without divine intervention or universal consciousness, the ultimate cause of reality and all its inherent potentialities being chance or an inevitability would effectively be a miracle. After all, this is what miracles are. Things that do not conform to our perceived cause and effect reality. Also, if it was inevitable rather than chance, this would mean the apparent randomness observed is actually pseudo-randomness, because inevitability by chance is an oxymoron unless every possibility can be played out in alternative universes. And even this imaginative and wholly unprovable infinite universe's explanation would still leave unanswered questions about the origins of the arbitrary laws of nature, energy and matter, etc., as well as the origin of the multiverse. It also fails to properly address the issue about apparent randomness being pseudo-randomness, because there has to be a mechanism behind the allocation of the infinite possibilities into each and every universe. This allocation may seem as random from an observer's perspective, but what determines which of each universe gets its version of the infinite possibilities? And what mechanism is there to assure the rule is never broken? It is always assumed that true randomness just exists, and there is no need for an explanation regarding its ultimate cause, and yet there is paradoxically high order in terms of how it works. There is a distinction between apparent randomness in events within space-time, such as tossing coins, and a seemingly true randomness witnessed in quantum mechanics, and it is the latter form that I am referring to here. A more detailed explanation of the difference appears later in the book, because it is highly relevant to how our universe seems to have evolved as it has. The reason all phenomena have been downgraded from miraculous by most scientists and non-scientists alike is that pattern recognition has been mistaken for true understanding. There is a huge difference between observing a process unfold as well as identifying the pattern and order and knowing why the system and order should even arise in reality, or why the theatre that is reality should exist, let alone inherent potentialities. The process of evolution itself, for example, is not so difficult to follow. The miracle lies in the potentiality for such a process. Einstein said, "The most incomprehensible thing about the universe is that it is comprehensible." But I think that from a scientific viewpoint, the whole of existence is incomprehensible too, as are the potentialities that manifest as comprehensible phenomena. Reductionism has served science well, and is no doubt a useful method. However, it is nothing short of a display of hubris to believe the gaping holes will all be filled by the same method. This belief is known as scientism, and like all fundamentalism, it treats partial truths as though they were the total truth. Despite the shortcomings of science, the book is not about religion, although religion and spirituality are relevant and receive more than a passing mention. Much of the meaning of life can be discussed without reference to a potential spiritual element or the mysteries surrounding the origin and reality of life. However, whether atheist scientists like it or not, this rabbit out of the hat reality from nowhere and the origins of the arbitrary comprehensible laws of nature are currently, and may always be, beyond science. And there is mounting evidence that everything is ultimately consciousness emerging from a timeless and spaceless realm. A spiritual dimension is not easily provable, but there are many reasons to believe it exists that does not require a blind leap of faith of the kind Buddha cautioned against. Spirituality is discussed near the end of the book for the benefit of those with an open mind. For the most part, the book is intended for believers and atheists alike because it focuses primarily, although not exclusively, on processes that appear to be the consequences of the potentialities inherent in the nature we are part of, rather than how these potentialities came into being. Of course, there is a possibility we are living in a simulated universe and all is contrived. But the exploration of the true base reality, whatever that is, would lead to a similar discussion on spirituality anyway. Who or what created the base reality and the simulated programmers? Given that we can experience something as profound as pleasure and pain, and do so as actual sensations rather than merely as measurements taken from a kind of barometer, it would not matter so much if this is a simulation. The difference between us being authentic entities or simulated ones are indistinguishable from our perspective. In other words, we are real in some sense, even if our reality is a constructed simulation. I believe people are hypernormalized, taking all commonly experienced phenomena for granted. The term hypernormalized is based on the BBC documentary title Hypernormalization, made by a British filmmaker, Adam Curtis. The documentary argues that governments, financiers, and technological utopians have, since the 1970s, given up on the complex real world and built a simpler fake world, run by corporations and kept stable by politicians. My use of the word hypernormalization is much broader and refers to the fact that everyone is born into a world with arbitrary phenomena that quickly becomes all too familiar because due to the pre-existence of these phenomena, how to engage with them is all that matters. How things come to be as they are is rarely questioned by most people. Einstein said, "There are only two ways to live your life, as though nothing is a miracle, or as though everything is a miracle." Due to the impact of hypernormalization and the human ability to recognize patterns and adapt, many people think that what they encounter in their daily lives is nothing extraordinary. A belief held by scientists that all the order we witness in reality came about through self-creation, as did the universe itself and everything therein, strengthens this common worldview. Hypernormalization is as prevalent within the scientific community as it is within the population as a whole. Scientists are generally all too willing to accept countless axioms as non-metaphysical, and this is closely related to the belief that reductionism will ultimately reveal all of nature's secrets, which was mentioned earlier. When we look to science to explain ultimate causes, it becomes clear that science has no answer. Is science merely observing and attempting to explain that which is an illusion operating by certain principles in this reality? A simple example of hypernormalization is to consider how a child learns about the effects of gravity. It can see a kind of pulling force in action, but of course, the way in which gravity actually works is far more profound. Newton created a mathematical framework that allowed for a good approximation. Then Einstein viewed it as the bending of space-time and brought us a more accurate and in-depth account of gravity. But how it actually works and came to be is still not understood. Most simply accept all that is and busy themselves within the constructed bubble, little different from animals that simply act in accordance with the way evolution programmed them. Understanding reality at its deepest level does not significantly affect mortality, happiness, or genetic fitness, which is discussed later in the book. Accordingly, the main incentive to philosophize is the capacity to do so thanks to evolved intelligence and creative thinking combined with a sense of curiosity that we all have in varying degrees. Hypernormalization is not limited to an incomplete understanding and often unquestioned acceptance of external phenomena, but also includes how our own thoughts and behavior work as well. Even our senses do not work in the way that our experience of them would have us believe in the absence of some deep thinking and experimentation. For example, when you look at a red rose, you are actually seeing the map and not the territory. Although the eyes, the sensory organs, are able to distinguish the relevant wavelengths of the reflected light, the brain is closed off in the dark. It is the electrochemical impulses received in the brain that, in turn, provoke specific regions of the brain to manufacture the red you see in your mind's eye. In other words, the perception or experience of colour is formed by consciousness and is effectively a form of imagination, although different wavelengths form different mind-created colours because the resulting electrical impulses vary depending on the wavelength. And this informs the mind what colours to add into the picture stroke mind projection. This is doubtless quite a profound realisation for the majority of people. Most see a red rose and wrongly assume that red is a characteristic of the petals, as well as a phenomenon that exists out there in the so-called physical reality. In other words, they falsely believe that they see a kind of photographic facsimile that is indistinguishable from the true out there phenomena. The illusion is so strong that the same doubtless even believe the existence of eyes means that what they see is simply direct stroke unpolluted information that the eyes receive and do not contemplate the role of the brain and ultimately the mind. The colours are paradoxically made real because our mind and consciousness create that reality. But they are an illusion because without a conscious observer there to convert wavelengths into things we call colour, there would be no such phenomenon. The whole of what you see is in fact a virtual reality, albeit a fairly accurate reflection of seemingly physical objects in view. The fact you can see distant skies and stars, a huge depth of field that is projected by consciousness in such a way it is perceived way in front of the skull, has led some to postulate that it is not simply a recreation in the mind, but that the mind projects out to what is seen. They theorize that our consciousness weakly interacts with matter, as well as providing us with information coming in one way through the eyes. Even if this controversial hypothesis turns out to be wrong, and the process is strictly one way, and the mind creates our virtual reality in such a way that it just appears to be reprojected beyond our skulls onto corresponding objects in our reality, it is still a virtual reality at the very least, because as mentioned earlier, no photons or light get into the brain itself, which is a closed-off unit sat in absolute darkness. This is true of all senses. The smell of a banana, for example, is derived from the molecules of the banana, but the final scent creation that is recognized as banana is a construct of the mind and consciousness based on the stimulation of certain areas of the brain that, in turn, creates the sensation stroke experience we label as smell. The molecules themselves do not enter the brain, but a process that almost certainly involves quantum mechanics, as well as a molecular lock and key type equivalent, translates the molecular information into a sensation within consciousness. All smells are invented and arbitrary. Although, as with all sensory experiences, I believe they are all fundamental given their specific nature and their uniformity. In other words, no prior benchmark to base the conscious experience on. Your blue may differ from my blue to some degree, but is certainly still a genuine visual colour experience formed by colourless light waves of a certain wavelength, a creation that cannot be considered an ordinary phenomenon of our material realm. Unsurprisingly, evolution has led to some smells being accompanied by emotional reactions to a sure attraction or repulsion. For example, rotting food is automatically experienced as a bad smell. This kind of revelation is consistent throughout the book and is why I believe it is a novel take on the meaning of life. The conclusions are a mixture of good and bad news. On the one hand, life is finite and meaning appears to be a human construct made real by consciousness. On the other hand, knowing what we really are and what the big picture looks like allows action that could enhance our experiences while we're in this absurd reality. For example, knowing about landmines such as impact bias, focus illusion, and freedom to choose, which are discussed in the book, can help enhance happiness, and knowing ways to alleviate mood disorders until future cures arise can help mitigate suffering. Although depression is a disease, unlike anorexia, the sufferer is not always fully deluded. With anorexia, there is a huge amount of evidence demonstrating the delusion. Belt size has shrunk, the mirror shows unhealthy thinness, friends and medical experts assure the anorexic there is a problem, the weighing scales provide information which shows that for their height the sufferer is significantly underweight, yet all this evidence often does not put an end to the delusion. With depression, there may be a minimizing of positives and maximizing of negatives and jumping to false, negative conclusions amongst the many negative thinking habits. But depressives also happen to have a more realistic take on chance and on self-assessment in terms of the perception of performance. This is known as depressive realism. Furthermore, when they feel no pleasure and no meaning due to the condition, it demonstrates that it is the anatomy and physiology of the brain, combined with consciousness, that create, stroke provide access to the positive feelings they no longer enjoy. Like colour and smell, these feelings are in a sense illusory and yet made real by the mind itself. Like all diseases, the logical aim is to alleviate the symptoms to provide a cure for the underlying physical condition. Unlike any other diseases, the condition shows us that the normal state may be normal from an evolutionary perspective, but is actually an enhanced state that assures motivation, meaning, and a sense of well-being. Given that this enhanced state is a potential that is enjoyed most of the time by most people, it illustrates that human consciousness has the capacity to experience it, and that there should be a remedy for all sufferers, even if the know-how and technology are currently too primitive to assist all sufferers. The truth is that there is a lot that is perceived by the mind as terrible about life, and I think most people have a guard against this. The terror management theory suggests that they overlook it. It is my belief that people who suffer from depression are more finely tuned to this reality, and in short, the condition results in the loss of necessary illusions. And humans need a certain amount of illusion to live. If there is a positive side to depression, I would say that it can be very humanizing and enhance empathy, but it is a huge price to pay, and hopefully this singular positive can be retained even once the disease has been banished. The question of the meaning of life does not even occur to some people because they are so engaged within the bubble, they don't often ponder on all that they, others, and also nature are. This applies to all human endeavours and experiences, from work and luck to reproduction and child rearing. However, experience what it is like with no feeling of meaning can understandably leave some to question what meaning itself really is. Losing the sense of meaning does not guarantee such a quest, but would surely make it more likely. When a depressive is in remission, they will probably forget how profound and real the feeling of no meaning is. It is as though it was the meaninglessness that was the illusion. Likewise, when everything seems permeated with meaninglessness, it is hard to imagine how normal people cannot see that there is no intrinsic meaning, and that life is absurd. The so-called normal go about their routines, human-centric behaviours, as though it all makes sense. Who is right? I would argue that both are, but even when there is apparent meaning, it is a kind of human construct nonetheless. From a big picture perspective, there is possibly an ultimate meaning that we will explore in detail. But the predisposition for humans to experience a sense of meaning has clearly led to a multitude of unrelated and arbitrary ways to enjoy it. At its worst, depression results in a sense that life is pointless, and this is felt as much, if not more, than it is deducted logically. This perpetual pain arises from a nagging feeling that the world is somehow not right, or although sufferers may know the rules and can maybe even appear to fit in, the nagging feeling remains. I believe it can often be a symptom of a lack of spiritual awakening. The animalistic behaviours can no longer pacify an evolved being that can see the futility of polishing the brass on the Titanic as its fate manifests. I think the fine-tuning many depressives experience that was referred to earlier, and which is also experienced by the spiritual, extends to a recognition that society as a whole is off-kilter. Perhaps not surprisingly, given the unquestioned rituals and traditions, hypermaterialism, vast deviations from evolved ancestral behaviour, to say nothing of the unstoppable, immoral and selfish drive that is almost ubiquitous. With politics as a catalyst, we have also seen the demise of community spirit and a rise in social isolation, along with the unashamed encouragement of selfishness. Where kites were once held, we see selfie sticks. Where children playing out together was the norm, we now see mobile phone and games addiction. Jiddu Krishnamurti expressed this well in a quotation saying, "It is no measure of health to be well adjusted to a profoundly sick society." Even though many people may live their lives believing there is nothing wrong, they have to accept that global warming, deforestation, plastic-infested seas, wars, rape, violence, genocide, homelessness, drug addiction, and a thousand other indicators of a descent into hell on earth are ever present. This part, at least from the observation of the physical realm, of the nagging feeling that the world is not right, is far from illusory to an observer. Yet, does focusing energy on what appears real create more of this physical reality? This thinking is dangerous territory, and as the possibility to sense meaning is real, this is clearly where the key focus should be. Whether a spiritual awakening is part of the remedy is less important than a return to the sense of meaning. Indefinite meaninglessness is the ultimate thief when it comes to the quality of life, and so various potential remedies for mood disorder are discussed near the end of the book. As mentioned earlier, although this is not a book about mood disorders, they are highly relevant because they not only help us understand what constitutes human meaning, they can also force deep thinking about the big picture. Meaning requires both consciousness and the brain to function in such a way that meaning is felt, but in the absence of some kind of spiritual dimension, there can be no ultimate meaning. The fact that meaning is contrived by the human mind does not mean that the meaning is not real, though. In the same way that pain is merely represented by brain activity, the existence of consciousness makes it very real. A robot could mimic the response to pain and be made to respond to different pressure levels indicating the damage being sustained, but it would never actually feel pain in the absence of consciousness. Simply because emotions such as distress, love, and a sense of meaning have evolved in a similar way to physical traits, in other words, evolved and harnessed for biological reasons, it doesn't mean that they are not a perceived physical reality. In the same way that altruism may have developed from symbiotic selfish behavior, it is still real in its final form. The advent of consciousness and rational thought means that altruism can be viewed as an independent state and real in its own right. In other words, true empathy has emerged in most humans. And as the human mind and consciousness has developed, the range of emotions and tastes have grown, so that there are countless things that can provide us with meaning. This includes a sense of meaning that is associated with our animalistic behaviour, as well as the near infinite number of contrived human activities, provided, of course, that the ability to feel meaning is present. I believe a sense of meaning was an evolutionary necessity and arose or was harnessed for various reasons. One was probably simply a spandrel, in other words, a consequence of the evolution of our consciousness, but a key reason is that extreme nihilism would be selected against by evolution because suicidal behaviour does not perpetuate gene transfer. To counter the emergence of self-awareness, and in particular a sense of our own mortality, the co-evolution of a sense of meaning and possibly religiosity may have been a necessity to avoid extinction. For similar reasons, most agricultural ancestors probably didn't ponder the probability of a crop failure. There is clearly an evolutionary advantage to being optimistic and motivated, and so it is universally innate to varying degrees. A game of pool to a depressive is an observation in physics. The winning or losing and the concept of competition are understood, but it seems a futile pastime. After all, the outcomes are soon forgotten, and it is only the hardwired instinct for competition that makes a win more pleasurable than a loss for someone who can experience meaning. The problem, of course, is that the feeling does not stop at games like pool, but can extend to all activities undertaken by humankind. Also, knowing our own mortality adds weight to the feeling for most depressives, because it is clear that whatever one does in life, it will be extinguished, from the achiever's viewpoint, when life is over. From the perspective of DNA, this is all irrelevant, as long as the drive for survival and reproduction is maintained. But for many egocentric beings that are really just mortal gene transfer mechanisms, it is a hard pill to swallow. A fear of harmless spiders is somewhat irrational, albeit the response is explainable from an evolutionary perspective. Existential angst is more rational, despite it being equally pointless. The cause of fear in this latter instance has the direst of consequences, but cannot be changed. As Andrew Solomon pointed out in his TED talk, sufferers of depression and existential angst often say things like, "No matter what we do, we're all going to die in the end," or, "There can be no true communion between two human beings when each of us is trapped in our own body." He suggests that all we can really say to this is, "That's true, but I think we should focus right now on what to have for breakfast." This is humorous and tragic in equal measures, because the swift changing of subjects to the most trivial of matters is not just a distraction to lighten a heavy conversation, it is also a kind of admission that the morbid insights cannot be disputed. For those who have experienced existential angst, The almost ubiquitous ability for people to block out these deep and disturbing truths is quite surprising. After all, many trivial events cause huge upset for many people, and yet the consequences of these are dwarfed by comparison. It seems that some have an acceptance of this inevitability and compartmentalise it, keeping emotionally arousing thoughts on the issue at bay, often subconsciously. This is part of the terror management theory referred to earlier. Others are pacified by their beliefs in religion or spirituality. Of course, most people do not enter Disneyland lamenting about the fact the day's experience will soon be over, and so, for the majority of people, the journey of life provides enough fulfillment to justify living despite knowing it is finite. This is why the need for a sense of meaning is necessary. And yet, it is conspicuous in its absence in Abraham Maslow's theory of sequential development, which is to do with human needs. I would suggest that it is as vital as all the basic needs he identified. With no meaning, many people will no longer care about these other identified needs. They would rather not play at being human at all. Meaning was added into Maslow's theory as revisions were made, but it refers to a need to seek and achieve meaning, whereas I'm referring to a fundamental need to have a sense, like a strong feeling, that life is other than pointless. People generally have a sense of connectedness with reality, even if they are bored or sad. If this capacity is lost and nothing provides pleasure or meaning, the world is not only mechanistic, it is sadistic. Or, in the words of Shakespeare's character Macbeth, it is a tale told by an idiot, full of sound and fury signifying nothing. Why existentialism can lead to meaninglessness, or vice versa, is discussed in more detail in the chapter on Leo Tolstoy's life and his desperate search for meaning. Although the book contains well-considered and reasoned arguments throughout, I anticipate diametrically opposing views from much of the scientific community on some aspects. Science is a wonderful institution, with the best available means of accruing reliable knowledge about the physical world. However, scientists become attached to their theories and hypotheses, and not only think about which explanations are a true reflection of their perception of reality, but also think about their careers and their intellectual legacy. This means that sometimes new ways of thinking are treated with suspicion and often hostility. It is important not to let these emotions cloud the scientific debates due to attachment, and to try to let the scientific ideas be evaluated on their explanatory merits and experimental evidence. I am less optimistic than one of science's greats, namely Carl Sagan. He said, "In science, it often happens that scientists say, you know, that's a really good argument, my position is mistaken. And then they would actually change their minds. And you never hear that old view from them again. They really do it. It doesn't happen as often as it should because scientists are human and change is sometimes painful. But it happens every day. I cannot recall the last time something like that happened in politics or religion." I am more than happy to hear opposing views on anything that is asserted in the book, as I have no vested interest in what turns out to be the true account of the meaning of life and our reality. At the very least, I think most readers of this book will see the world in a very different light, and will realise that things are far from what they seem. Before we begin our journey into what has to be the most complex whodunit mysteries of all time, it should be noted that the answer to the book title is not revealed in any individual chapter, but comes into focus by piecing together all of the chapters. Reading the conclusion alone will certainly not provide complete answers to the meaning of life, as there are too many interrelated subject matters involved to be able to answer the question in a summary. In one of the key chapters, the highly complex argument showing that natural selection cannot be the sole mechanism and driving force in biological evolution leaves a potential vacuum, which a later chapter on the primacy of mathematics and intelligence helps to fill. Decoding the meaning of life, especially in its broadest sense, was bound to unveil a blueprint that is somewhat difficult to comprehend. Some chapters may even require multiple reads, especially if you are not familiar with the processes of evolution or if lateral thinking is not one of your main strengths. However, I hope that you persevere because some of the key truths are revealed in the latter half of the book, and I am sure you will feel a sense of satisfaction by rising to the challenge. It is surely worth it to get to see reality at a much deeper and richer level than you could ever imagine possible, and to explore the deepest question of mankind, one that has stubbornly remained unanswered since time began. In answering the question, what is the meaning of life in its broader sense, the book essentially presents a theory of everything. Chapter 2. There is a superior mind that reveals itself in the world of experience. Albert Einstein. The meaning of life, the shorter answer. One writer concluded that the meaning of life is to leave the world in a better state than it was found and to contribute to society, even if that means sacrificing individual happiness. I would suggest that this is wrong on two counts. Firstly, when people want to know the meaning of life, they want to know if there is something more than birth, sickness, aging, and death. They want to know if there is something beyond our biological and social function. In other words, the conclusion does not go deep enough and explore what meaning itself actually is. Secondly, the conclusion is clearly subjective and a prescription for how the writer believes all humans should act in accordance with his own evolved moral compass. It is more of a generic political manifesto than an exploration of the meaning of life. From the DNA's perspective, everything is about survival and reproduction. As mentioned earlier, all animals, including us, are simply gene transfer mechanisms, DNA baton passers. There are hardwired drivers to assure this, although humans can choose to refrain from the reproduction function and even the act that was designed to facilitate reproduction. Evolutionary psychology proposes that it is not only our physical traits that evolved. Behavioural traits did too. This makes us mere puppets and removes most, if not all, the possibility of free will. Being conscious of this perhaps offers a sliver of free will, but most people are seemingly not awake and are unaware of the fact that pretty much all of our endeavours are governed by the products of evolution. For a more basic animal, such as a peacock, in addition to its survival behaviour, it has rudimental mating behaviours. Its beauty, and probably its gene quality, fitness, are displayed via energetic movement, bird noises, including ones outside the human hearing range, and quality of tail. The peahen is discerning and choosy, but not via human-like rational thinking. It is actually a process known in biology as sexual selection, and many evolutionary biologists and evolutionary psychologists believe it is merely another form of natural selection. In other words, they see these traits arising as adaptations which assure the fittest survive by creating a kind of test that those lacking fitness will fail because of the inability to produce immaculate displays, thus providing visual and auditory cues used by peahens known as fitness indicators. In the same way that adaptations have arisen out of environmental challenges, it is theorized that the capacity for mate choice and sexual selection has resulted in further adaptations that work in the same way and is, therefore, natural selection at work via an indirect process. In other words, weeding out the weakest. Together, natural and sexual selection form Darwin's theory of evolution, and although many biologists see it as infallible, there are questionable aspects that will be discussed throughout the book. Ironically, Darwin did not see sexual selection as a part of natural selection as nearly all biologists do at present. He made it absolutely clear that sexual selection, in his view, is all about the creation and advancement of beauty for beauty's sake. In other words, resulting in traits and behaviours that usually affect survival chances in a detrimental way. The chapter entitled Beauty concurs with Darwin, but explores what beauty is, why it exists, and what really drives it. Here is just one of Darwin's quotations about sexual selection and its role in the creation of beauty. A number of male animals, as is the case for all our most gorgeous birds, some fishes, reptiles and mammals, and a host of magnificently coloured butterflies, have been rendered beautiful for beauty's sake. When Charles Darwin considered the characteristics of the peacock's tail, he said, "The sight of a feather in a peacock's tail, whenever I gaze at it, makes me sick." Those were his exact words, which he wrote in 1860, the year after he published his Origin of Species, words that inspired my peacock cartoon illustration earlier in this chapter. It wasn't until 1871, 11 years later, that Darwin provided a detailed and comprehensive account of his theory of sexual selection in The Descent of Man, in an effort to provide a naturalistic, evolutionary, explanation for peacock feathers and other seemingly useless male ornaments. He thought he could explain two of the animal kingdom's most conspicuous and puzzling features: weaponry and adornment. Sometimes, males competing fiercely for females would enter a sort of evolutionary arms race, developing ever greater weapons, tusks, horns, antlers, as the best endowed males of each successive generation reproduced at the expense of their weaker peers. In parallel, among species whose females choose the most attractive males based on their subjective tastes, males would evolve outlandish sexual ornaments. It is now well known that all sexes exert numerous different evolutionary pressures on one another, and that in some species males choose ornamented females, but to this day, many of the best studied examples are of female preference and male display. Darwin seemed happy to accept that beauty simply happened thanks to some kind of innate aesthetic appreciation sense in the females that assures beauty is constructed from millions of random mutations, effectively assembling a microscopic jigsaw puzzle over countless generations. This might account for some of the cruder expressions of beauty, but cannot explain the mathematically complex pattern and ornament we see in the male Argos pheasant, for example. In sexual selection, the choosiness trait is heritable, meaning female offspring will seek beauty, and the quality genes often apparently indicated in the optimum displays of beauty too. Furthermore, the choosing of greater beauty and potentially better genes will result in more attractive and sought-after male offspring. The male and female offspring will also benefit from having a good genes father in terms of improved survival rates. Thus, mate choice assures that choosiness perpetuates, and that the beautiful traits in males does too, which is also heritable. If the aesthetic nature of the whole pattern and ornament of the tail and or other showy traits are coincidental and not the result of hardwired unconscious goals that assure beauty over time from a starting point of drab, it would mean it arises through blind chance. And given that beauty is ubiquitous amongst thousands of species of birds, to say nothing of thousands of other animals, there is clearly something more than chance at work. Gene fitness could feasibly be displayed once the masterpieces are constructed or well underway. However, the idea of gene fitness being the cause of beauty, whereby random mutations purportedly simultaneously construct such beauty blindly and afford some apparent improved fitness with each microscopic step from proto-ornament to complex ornament, with no functional reason that the new abstract partial marking could signal stroke provide any greater fitness than a specimen without such mutations or a specimen sporting any other random markings alternative, is seriously flawed. The handicap theory, which is associated with gene fitness indicators, also has serious flaws. These flaws are detailed in the chapter on beauty, and it turns out these fatal flaws have profound implications on the ultimate cause of beauty. This chapter is more of an introduction to natural selection and sexual selection, and what they show us about the meaning of life in terms of their ability to shape traits without the need for free will. It is also about the concept of gene fitness indicators, which probably exists in some traits once they are well established, but, it is contended, are not ubiquitous and are probably quite rare, despite the contrary beliefs of evolutionary biologists and evolutionary psychologists. In bowerbirds, beauty and possibly gene fitness is displayed mainly by behavioural rather than physical traits, although they have physical beauty and energetic display mating rituals too. Each of the males builds an elaborate and colourful garden, which includes the collection and replacement of strategically placed flowers and berries. The choosiness predisposition of the female is utilised in the assessment of the male bowerbird's garden and the inverted nest type construction known as the bower. This construct offers a quick and easy exit viewing spot for the potential mate to see the bird's handiwork, as well as a mating area should she signal her consent. The prize awarded to the winner is sex. It is quite astonishing to see how evolution can shape not only the physical traits of an animal, but also its mating rituals and other behaviours, growing ever more elaborate in accordance with the female's preference and or to keep fitness indicators true, as the theory goes. The bowerbird's gardens look man-made and have a beauty which demonstrates that their display and physical traits appeal to the human sense of beauty as well as that of the female bowerbirds. It is more than a coincidence though, because what manifests as beauty and or gene fitness is mathematical in nature and is a presentation of order and often striking colour arrangements, with the appeal of these being carried forward to us. We favour facets like symmetry, for example, both in human faces and in art and architectural structures, a throwback from sexual selection in other species that ultimately manifested in us. Beauty is also associated with order, the antipathy of randomness, and consciousness appears to appreciate this state, as though mind, or manifest consciousness, enjoys conspicuous displays of mathematical forms and order, manifest consciousness. In other words, consciousness attracted to consciousness-created masterpieces, which is manifest consciousness in the world of experience. Before the materialist scientists among you are quick to judge this additional definition of beauty, I refer you back to the quotation by Einstein at the beginning of the chapter. There is a superior mind that reveals itself in the world of experience. Gene fitness indicators and sexual selection, like natural selection, have always felt like incomplete theories to me. This will be more obvious by the time you have read the whole book, as there are countless pieces of evidence showing the difficulties that arise once you resist hypernormalization. What actually appears to be going on becomes quite obvious, and it is not the processes that are blind, as many scientists believe, but seemingly the scientists themselves. The fact that mate choice seems to correlate with the selection of mates sporting the best traits, deemed as gene fitness indicators, makes the theory of gene fitness indicators as a cause of beauty appear credible. But this assumption is merely based upon what is observed and, as ever, ignores ultimate causes. It is worth noting that a 2012 meta-analysis of 90 studies on 55 species found only equivocal support for the good genes hypothesis, and so it appears that many of the so-called gene fitness indicators are not reliable advertisements of fitness after all. This, of course, casts further doubt on the idea that all animal, beauty, stroke, mathematical order, stroke, pattern and ornament has arisen as a result of random mutations leading to greater and greater indicators of gene fitness due to natural selection in the form of sexual selection. With zero free will, these animals are merely a part of nature, morphing over generations due to external forces in a highly ordered fashion en route to striking beauty. It is difficult to see how anyone can believe the process is completely unguided, because micro-improvements leading to such mathematical beauty and wonder cannot happen by chance. And animal preference alone cannot explain the drive towards incomprehensible order apparent in much of the pattern and ornament we witness. The best display of mating behaviour and possibly gene fitness has to be the sand-based artwork of the pufferfish, and you can see a link in this in the social media for the Meaning of Life book series. There is no doubt that we are witnessing an expression of intelligence, and yet the intelligence is expressed through the organism rather than being something the organism is consciously manifesting. The chapter dedicated to the primacy of mathematics and intelligence explores the ultimate causes in greater detail. The same principle that applies to peacocks and bowerbirds applies to humans, but the number of aesthetic developments through sexual selection and possibly gene fitness indicator evolution is far greater. There are still physical considerations such as build, breast size, stroke symmetry, facial symmetry, etc., but behavioural traits have become a huge consideration and now dominate the process. The gene mutation load, potential for faulty genes, in the brain stroke mind will be significant due to its complexity, and so is the best place for gene fitness stroke sexually selected traits to be revealed. As such, wealth, intelligence, generosity, power, wit, sense of humour, storytelling skills, and creativity are the main currencies in human sexual selection. When referring to gene fitness here, I use the term to include fitness as a choice of mate rather than just the overall gene quality, in light of the fact many are probably not necessarily reliable indicators of genetic superiority, as we have discussed at length. Although a good-looking male may have above-average gene quality, in other words, low-quality genes may have diminished the beauty potential, I suspect looks will not prove to be a great indicator of long-term immunity, prowess, or mortality. Accordingly, what is often attributed to gene fitness really indicates the chooser's innate taste for beauty, as well as conscious and subconscious assessments of attributes that are beneficial to the chooser and/or their potential offspring. I hope you enjoyed the excerpt. Just to let you know that the book gets more upbeat as it progresses. And to reflect this, here is a song by It's a Global Records. It's called Promise Me, and it's by Matt Huxley featuring Paula James, and it's the extended Jam Cat mix.